Okay, we're looking at the parables that I have grouped under the heading, "The Kingdom is Good News for the Needy." As I said, there's some, sometimes you'll see one, you say, well, that probably would have fit better under there. Okay, I just did what I, you know, put them where I thought they would best go, and there's some question about whether I've always chosen the best category. But last week we finished up looking at the parable of the two debtors in Luke chapter 7, 41 to 43, and then we looked at the three parables in Luke chapter 15, all of which were told in response to the Pharisees and scribes grumbling against Jesus for fraternizing with sinners. And see, that's very important because you see that sets the context, what he's after in telling these parables. Now, when we ended, we were looking at the final of those parables, the parable of the lost son. In Luke 15, 11 to 32, I have a few additional things I want to say about that parable, and then we'll move on. Now, you recall that in the parable of the lost son, the father's younger son brashly asks for and receives his portion of the inheritance while his father's still alive, and then he promptly goes to a distant country where he and the assets are unavailable to help the father. But he takes his inheritance, goes to a distant country, he squanders the wealth in self-indulgent living, and then he's reduced to feeding pigs to survive. He comes to his senses, he repents, he returns home, and he is received warmly and richly by the Father. Now in Luke 15, 25 to 32, the story turns to the older brother. And that's what I want to finish up with there. The older brother who's angry and resentful over the father's celebratory reception of the younger son. And as I pointed out right at the end of the class last week, the older brother's attitude is precisely the attitude of the Pharisees and scribes toward those they saw as sinners. You see, those who lived unholy and shameful lives, they objected to Jesus fraternizing with such people because they did not share the Father's love for those people. In their mind, these sinners' blatant mistreatment and dishonoring of God made them unworthy of actively pursuing, let alone rejoicing over, should they return. In other words, they had burned their bridges as far as these guys were concerned. What are you messing with them for? And that is exactly what you see here. Now, the parable makes clear that it is Jesus who's working for the joy of the Father, and that in grumbling against his outreach, the Pharisees and scribes, they stand like the older brother in opposition to the Father. It's an appeal to them to share in God's joy over the recovery of lost sinners, and thus to change their attitude toward lost sinners. In terms of the parable, it's an invitation to those grumbling against him, to the Pharisees and scribes. It's an invitation for them to go in and join the celebration over the younger brother's return. That's what that's about. Now, the fact the father tells the older son in verse 31, he says that you're always with me and all that is mine is yours. That's not an indication that the Pharisees and scribes are right with God. I mean, not at all. On the contrary, you see, the main point of the parable is to show how out of step they are with God. The main point is to show that their attitude toward penitent sinners is the opposite of God's. See, his attitude is celebration. Their attitude toward penitent sinners is disdain and resentment. Rather, the statement in verse 31, it simply highlights the unreasonableness of their resisting joyful celebration of penitent sinners by showing that it doesn't come at the expense of whatever blessings the Father may have in store for them. As I said last week, it's not a zero-sum game. That's what he's saying to them. My celebration and joyful reception of penitent sinners doesn't come at your expense. So he wants them to see that, you see. And the question that's left open by the parable is whether the Pharisees and the scribes will, like the younger son in the parable, whether they will return to the Father and receive those blessings, whether they will cease dishonoring the Father and obey his desire that penitent sinners be received gladly. Will they stop that? As they grumble against Jesus, will they come and side with Jesus, side with the Father, or will they continue to resist? So that's what the parable leaves open for them. Now the last parable, I should have shown you that, verse 31. The last parable I've put in this group is in Luke 18, 9 through 14, the Pharisee and the tax collector. That parable occurs there, only there in Luke. In Luke chapter 18, verse 9, it specifies that the parable was told to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. You see, so that context gives you the target of the parable. The target of the parable is the religiously smug, those who saw themselves as worthy before God because they obeyed so well. See, that's who he's after. And those who treated with contempt, those they perceive to be less sufficiently or insufficiently devout. So it's those who look at themselves as, you know, we're really on track. We're really on board. You see, we obey so well. We're worthy before God. And then, of course, they look at those who they deem to be insufficiently pious, and they look at them with contempt. So Jesus says that. So you see that in 18:9. That's the target of the parable. Then he says in Luke 18:10-14, two men went up into the temple to pray. One a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all I get, of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. As you know, Pharisees, they took their religion very seriously. They were devoted to observing the law, and they were very concerned about ritual purity. As Arlen Hultgren says, according to Josephus, the Pharisees were the most observant of all the identifiable Jewish groups, and they were held in high regard among the masses of the people. Now that strikes us because, you know, we look at Pharisees, ooh, Pharisees, terrible. The masses of the people in the first century regarded Pharisees as the epitome of piety. These were the people they saw as the religiously devout. And tax collectors, on the other hand, they were seen by the masses, they were seen by the people in the society as being on the other end of the spectrum. So we've got here the most pious, and then the tax collectors on the other end. The main taxes that Rome collected from Jews in Judea and in Galilee, the main taxes they required them to pay. You had a tax on the produce of the land, you had a per person tax, and you had taxes on goods being transported, which would be something like our sales tax. You see, so you had on the produce a per-person tax, and those are called direct taxes, those first two. The third tax, which is a tax on transporting goods, that was an indirect tax. Now, the direct taxes, those were collected by councils of Jewish leaders and their representatives, and those were collected on an annual basis. The third kind, the indirect tax, that you have this tax on goods being transported, that was collected by a person who bid for the right to collect those taxes within a given political district. So somebody would come to Rome for those indirect taxes, taxes on the transportation of goods, and he would come and say, listen, I will pay you, Rome, X amount of bucks, and in exchange, I will be empowered to collect the indirect taxes in this specific political district. Well, you can see how that would operate, right? Now, the people to whom Rome farmed out this tax collection, they are the tax collectors that you see mentioned in the New Testament. They were Jews, and they made their living collecting more than they had paid in advance to Rome. That's how they would do it, you see. So I will pay Rome X amount of bucks, and I will hope to collect X plus whatever. And so that's profit to me. So I keep everything I collect because I've paid Rome in advance. So do you see that there's a built-in incentive for fraud? Because I'm keeping everything I collect. I've already paid Rome, and that's how I wind up making my money. And there's room for dishonesty because the collector of these indirect taxes had the power to determine the value of certain goods. So I'm the guy benefiting by the taxes, and I also have the power, if you're saying you're transporting these goods, there's a tax on them connected to the value, and I'm the one who gets to say what they're worth. So not only do you have this built-in incentive for fraud, but you have this great potential for dishonesty, so it shouldn't surprise us that tax collectors in the first century were notorious for their dishonesty. In addition, the collectors of both direct taxes, the Jewish councils that collected those annually, and the indirect taxes, those who bid for the right to do that, both of those groups, they were despised for their collusion with Rome. They were viewed as collaborating with an occupying power. They're Jews who are helping these people collect the money helping the Romans collect money from Jews. So you had that angle to it, that they were despised for that reason. And the attitudes toward tax collectors, especially those collecting the indirect taxes because of their fraud and dishonesty, were very negative. The Mishnah, which is a codification of oral law in the early 3rd century, maybe as early as 200, but it's a codification of oral tradition that goes back perhaps centuries, perhaps to the 1st century. There, that tax collectors are classified with murderers and robbers. Just to give you an idea of how we're taxed. So what do we have? We have over here, we've got the most pious people. We've got this Pharisee who's considered the epitome of piety in the society. And on the other end, we've got this guy who's considered lower than what? You know, lower than lawyers today. Which reminded me, by the way, a guy walks by and sees a tombstone. Here lies a lawyer and an honest man. And he says, what about that? Two guys in one grave. Yeah. So... So this is what you have. You know, I was trying to think of a parallel. Maybe in our society it would be like a missionary, although in our culture missionaries probably aren't very, you know, seen as pious people. But in some circles it would be like a missionary on one hand, and over here we have a corrupt politician. You see, you have to see this. This is what gives the parable its punch. You have to recognize that they're on different ends, you see, of the spectrum. Now, both the Pharisee and the tax collector, they go up to the temple to pray, the customary hours for which would be 9 a.m. and 3 p.m. That's with the morning and evening sacrifices. And the English Standard Version and many other translations may be correct in translating the first part of verse 11, the Pharisee standing by himself. Now, they may be correct in that, but I think along with Joseph Fitzmyer, John Noland, Arland Hultgren, the New English Translation, I think more can be said for the translation, the Pharisee stood and prayed about himself. You see, that is a acceptable and I think probably preferable translation. That you can either have him standing by himself or standing and praying about himself. And one of the things that makes me think that's probably the right way to go is that he opens with a nod toward God. But then the content of his prayer is about his superior piety in relation to other people. His prayer is self-congratulatory, and it shows disdain for those he judges to be morally defective. That's his prayer. Now, the tax collector's sense of his sin is reflected in his standing far off. He feels unworthy to be among the other people who have gathered at the temple to pray to God. See, he feels he can't even join in that group to be with them. That's what's reflected here. The tax collector standing far off. It is a sense, it's a reflection of his guilt. And he wouldn't even lift his eyes to heaven, which was a common posture for prayer. You would look and pray to God. And he wouldn't do that. He stands far off. He won't lift his eyes to heaven. And that's because of his sense of guilt. You see, he's unworthy to be among those who are praying. He's unworthy to look up at God. So he doesn't even do that. And his beating of his breast, this was a cultural thing. It was a sign of anguish or contrition. You can see in Luke 23:48 as an example. Anguish or contrition. You see, this person is completely broken over his sin. He feels guilty about it. So much so he stands far off, won't look up. He's beating on his breast. Because he's convicted and crushed. And his prayer is simply, God, be merciful to me. ESV says, a sinner. Literally, it says, the sinner. Be merciful to me, the sinner. You see, the way he sees himself, he's not just a sinner. He feels that he is a distinctive sinner. Which is how you often feel when you're convicted. You see that in Paul. I'm the greatest, you know, I'm the worst of sinners. You see, well, this is how this person feels, have mercy on me, the sinner. And then Jesus delivers the shocking verdict in verse 14. Shocking to the people who are hearing this. The Pharisee, the pious, the righteous, the holy, the worthless, the sinful, the scummy tax collector. And he sets it up. And then he delivers this verdict. The tax collector went home before God justified, whereas the Pharisee did not. And then the reason, he gives the reason, it's that everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. But he who humbles himself will be exalted. In other words, the way to justification is only by God's mercy. The way to justification with God is only by his mercy, and that mercy can be received only by one who recognizes his need for it. No one can come to God kicking down heaven's door and saying, "You're fortunate to have me." Aren't you fortunate, God, to have someone who obeys so well as I do? Who does absolutely all of these things. See, no one receives mercy who comes that way. See, those who seek to lay claim to God on the basis of their good works, on the basis of their performance, then those who seek that are left to stand on their performance, which inevitably leaves them unjustified. If you want to bring your life and performance before God and say, "I'm standing on this. This is the basis of our relationship. It is because of how good I am." If you stand on that as the basis of your standing in relationship with God, you are in trouble. Now, if you don't understand that, and if you don't sense that, then my advice to you is to engage in a little introspection about your own life. You see, but that's the thing. If you choose to stand on your performance and your life, you are not going to be justified. And it's evident here in the fact the Pharisees' disdain for people like this tax collector, it violates God's command to love one's neighbor. So here he is just hating and just disdaining this person, having no connection or anything to him. And yet he's coming to God saying, you know, you are really, you know, it's a good day for you to have me. No, see, a person comes to God like this tax collector, just broken. I don't care what you do or how you've done it. You will never stand before a holy, atomic, white God on the basis of your performance. Okay? So all that we have is a gift by God's mercy and grace. And to receive that, we must recognize our need for it. And so that's what you see. That's why he tells them that. Important, important stuff. Next category. Next category, my grouping of parables. The kingdom is bad news for the establishment. Kingdom's good news for the needy. But the kingdom's bad news for the establishment. And the first parable I want to look at here is the parable of two sons. This occurs only in Matthew chapter 21, verse 28 to 32. Now, there's a question about the original text of the parable. But all I'm going to say about that is that there are good reasons for accepting as original the text that is reflected in the vast majority of English translations, okay? So I'm not going to explore that. I'm just going to tell you there are good reasons for accepting the text that appears in the vast majority of English translations. Now, Jesus tells this parable in the context of an exchange in the temple between him and the chief priests and the elders of the people. They ask him in Matthew chapter 21, verse 23, by what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority? And Jesus tells them, he says, he'll answer their question if they first answer his. And then he asked them whether John's baptism was from heaven or from man. Now, this is more related to their question to him than one might think. As John Noland says in his commentary on Matthew, the leaders have questions about Jesus' authority precisely because they have never actually faced up to the challenge of John's message. That's why they have questions about his authority, because they've never faced up to the challenge of John's message. They refuse to answer Jesus' question. He says, John's baptism, was it from heaven? I'll answer your question. You answer mine first. His baptism, was it from heaven or was it from man? They refuse to answer Jesus' question because they see they'll be in trouble however they answer it. You see, they recognize they're going to be in trouble however they answer it. If they say John's baptism was from heaven, well, then they will have no answer for the inevitable follow-up question. Well, then why didn't you believe him? John's baptism was from heaven. Yes, it was from heaven. Well, then why didn't you believe him? And what are they going to say? So they understand we can't go that route. If they say John's baptism was from men, they'll face the wrath of the people who all accepted that John was a prophet. So they realize that either way they go on this question, they're going to be in trouble. And so they wind up saying, listen, we're not going to tell you. And Jesus then likewise refuses to answer their question to him. And that's why I say, I love these engagements with Jesus when these guys think they're going to trap him or get over on him. It's just beautiful. No, it's going to be you want to do that? And he just says, okay, I'll answer your question. Here, you answer mine first. Hama, 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 hama. We're not going to answer it. All right. I told you I'd answer yours if you answered mine. You're not going to answer mine, I'm not answering yours. You see, he it's like, you know, one of these battle of wits and they're unarmed. I mean, it's just, Jesus is, I mean, he, when you're in with him, it's just, it's something. Verse 25, it shows that the chief priests and the elders, they knew full well that if John's baptism was from heaven, see, meaning that if John was acting as God's agent and under God's authority, they knew full well that if that was the case, then they should have believed him. They should have believed him. To refuse the message of God's prophet is to refuse to obey God. They understood that. They knew that if his message was from heaven, if he's God's agent acting under God's authority, they should have believed him. Because to refuse to believe the prophet is to refuse to obey God. It's clear, however, from verse 25 and verse 32 that they did not believe him. They did not believe John. They understand if John's from heaven, then we should believe him. But they did not believe John. Now, presumably, they were among those who claimed John was possessed by a demon. As you see in Matthew 11, 18. Now, though they refused in this instance where Jesus has put them to this question, they refused in this instance to admit their denial that John's baptism was from heaven. They denied that. They didn't believe him. And they understood if it was from heaven, then we're to believe him. They didn't believe him. They didn't accept his message. But they're not willing to admit that. So they refused in this instance to admit that their denial that John's baptism was from heaven. They did deny that fact. That's why they didn't believe him. But Jesus, he tells them a parable that casts that denial of theirs, that John's baptism was from heaven, in the negative light in which that denial belongs. That's the context of the parable, and he tells them. What do you think? A man had two sons. And he went to the first and said, "Son, go and work in the vineyard today." And he answered, "I will not." But afterward he changed his mind and went. And he went to the other son and said the same. And he answered, "I go, sir," but did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I say to you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes go into the kingdom of God before you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even when you saw it, you did not afterward change your minds and believe him." See, the question after the story of the two sons, where he sits here, he tells them the story, and then he says, which of the two did the will of his father? He tells the story, then he asks that question. And that question, after the story, it gets the chief priest and the elders to pass judgment on themselves by acknowledging that the one who obeys the Father's will is the one who actually does what the Father wants, rather than the one who merely says he will do what the Father wants. So he gets them to say, which one did it? Well, he said, the one who said, "I'm not going to do it," but actually did it, versus the one who says, "I will do it," but didn't do it. So he says, who's the one doing the Father's will? The one who actually does it, rather than the one who simply says he will do what the Father wants. And Jesus then applies that admission to the religious leaders. He applies it to them by contrasting their refusal to believe John, which was a refusal to do what God wants, with the willingness of the tax collectors and the prostitutes to believe John. See, those the leaders held in contempt as vile sinners, those who initially had said no to God and had gone off into a lifestyle of immorality, they turned out through their acceptance of John's message to be the ones who did God's will, Whereas the leaders, despite professing their devotion to God's will, refused to do it by refusing to accept John's preaching. You see, so he tells them, this is what's going on. You rejected that. And the fruit of this last line here, it says, and even when you saw it, you see, the fruit of repentance in the lives of the sinners who had accepted John's message, it should have impressed the leaders and been an additional impetus for taking John's ministry seriously, but still they refused to believe John. You should have seen it when the tax collectors and the prostitutes came and said yes to John's message, and they showed the fruit of repentance in their lives. Shouldn't you have seen that and understood that John was onto something? And caused you to reevaluate John's ministry and his message? You see, John came, as you know, he came as God's herald and forerunner of the kingdom bringer, the Lord Jesus Christ. And his message to people was that they needed to repent, for the kingdom was at hand in the impending ministry of the one who was mightier than John, the one whose sandals he was unworthy to carry. He comes announcing the kingdom bringer who's coming behind him. The Lord Jesus is bringing his impending ministry. He's here on the scene, and John is announcing that. Here's what David Winham says. The distinction between John and Jesus is the difference between the police outrider in a procession and the royal or other dignitary following in his or her official car or carriage. In other words, John was a prophet looking forward, the last in the line, in fact. Jesus was the one looked forward to. The fulfillment of the prophetic hopes. But, and this is the point implied in the parable of the two sons, John and Jesus were part of the same cavalcade, the same revolutionary movement. He comes as the herald of the kingdom bringer. You see, he comes as the herald, and accepting the message of John the Baptist, sinners were making themselves kingdom ready. They were making themselves kingdom ready in that they turned from their sin and they looked for the one to whom John pointed. So that's what he's doing. He's coming and saying, in my wake is the kingdom bringer. Repent. For the kingdom is at hand in the impending ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ, the one whose sandals I'm not worthy to carry. And people were repenting and looking for the one John is announcing. They were making themselves kingdom ready. As a result, they were entering the kingdom of God in their embrace of Christ who was ushering in the kingdom. An embrace flowing from John's preparatory ministry. The priest and the elders, on the other hand, they were not entering the kingdom because they refused to embrace Christ in keeping with their refusal to believe John's message. You remember this text in Luke 7, 29 and 30? When all the people heard this and the tax collectors too, they declared God just, having been baptized with the baptism of John. He calls people, come repent. He's coming. Come repent. Get kingdom ready. I'm pointing to him. He says, but the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the purpose of God for themselves, not having been baptized by John. In rejecting John's message, they rejected God's purpose for themselves. And that's what Jesus is saying to them here. Here you have prostitutes, tax collectors, they're all here, and here you are, the pious people of the society. John comes and he's preaching kingdom arrival and repentance in anticipation of the ministry I'm bringing, the kingdom I'm ushering in, and you snubbed John. And even when you saw the fruit of what John had done, you still didn't believe his message. So who is doing the will of the Father? Those who originally said no and then did God's will in accepting John's message? Or you who purport to be so pious and say, yes, God, and then you reject his will in rejecting John's message? He says it's the tax collectors and the prostitutes. You see? So that's what Jesus is saying to them and hitting them with there. Now, the second one I want to look at in this category, of course, we'll just get to introduce this, and then I'll remind you of it next week, Lord willing. The parable of the wicked tenants. Now, this parable occurs in three Gospels. Matthew, you see, in 21, Mark 12, and in Luke chapter 20. Now, the context and the setting of the parable is the same in each Gospel, so I'm convinced that this is three accounts of the one event. Three accounts of the one telling of the Gospel. The wording of the parable in the three different Gospels is a bit different, but the story is essentially the same. Now, the difference in wording of the parable on this occasion is because the Gospels, the authors of the Gospels, are not giving the very words of Jesus. It's useful to understand this. What in Latin is ipsissima verba, the very words. The authors of the Gospels are not giving that. He almost certainly taught in Aramaic. And the Gospel writers are writing in Greek. You see, they're not giving. He's speaking Aramaic and they're writing in Greek. You see, so they're not giving you the very words that Jesus spoke. Rather, they are by divine inspiration faithfully representing in Greek the meaning of what Jesus said, which meaning can be accurately expressed in different wording, as anybody who's looked at English translations of the Bible can understand. Right? You can say the same thing, the same concept, the same truth in different wording. Just compare translations. You see, so that's the idea that you see here. They don't purport to be quoting Jesus. I mean, Hebrew and Greek had no equivalent of quotation marks. And in addition, what they're doing is the authors of the Gospel, by inspiration, by the work of the Spirit, they wind up shaping, you see, they shape what they're writing for the purpose of their Gospel. They have theological objectives and interests. And under the inspiration of the Spirit, they shape what they're writing, sometimes omitting, sometimes combining, sometimes summarizing things without ever misrepresenting Jesus. You see, that's the key. Without ever misrepresenting. So I want you to see that so you have the same event, the same parable, reported three different times with slight difference in wording. And I tell you that so you don't go, well, what is this? I'm trying to explain to you why that's no problem. You see, they're giving it to you under inspiration in Greek, and they're all giving you the same meaning, faithfully representing what the Lord said, his meaning, his intent. Okay? I think that's important. Matthew 21, verse 33 to 46. I'll probably just get to read it and then be chased out by the bell. Ah, there's one. See? He's messing with me. I know it. All right. It says, Matthew 21, 33 to 46. Hear another parable. There was a master of a house who planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a wine press in it and built a tower and leased it to tenants and went into another country. When the season for fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. And the tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did the same to them. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and have his inheritance. And they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, he will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruits in their seasons. Jesus said to them, have you never read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them. Indeed, they perceived he was speaking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds because they held him to be a prophet. All right, let me say, the vineyard, you have this parable, and it deals with this vineyard, and the vineyard was an Old Testament image for Israel. You see, and the fact that the language that you have here in the parable, it parallels Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. That supports the conclusion that the vineyard is here, in fact, being used as an image of Israel. And that's very important, I think, to understand. Now, those tending the vineyard, Israel's leaders, they had failed to produce from Israel the fruit of righteousness that God was due. He is due the fruit of righteousness. And the leaders of Israel, those tending this vineyard, those tending Israel, had failed to produce that, the righteousness that God was due. And God had repeatedly sent prophets to urge the people to be faithful to the covenant, to give him his due. But the leaders shamefully treated the prophets. You know Old Testament? You know what has happened as prophets are you have them coming up? You see? They won't listen to them. They mistreat them. They don't want to hear this from God. And that's what had happened. And Jesus was sent. He was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. You see that in Matthew 15, 21 to 24. Also look at Matthew 10, 5 and 6. See, he was the son. He's the son who's coming after many prophets, calling Israel again to repent. But this time calling them to repent in light of the kingdom's arrival. So he's the son sent after many prophets who had been mistreated. And he's calling again, calling Israel to repent, this time in light of the kingdom's arrival. He came bringing the blessings of the kingdom. You see, the receipt, I heard that bell, the receipt of which requires faith in him as the Messiah, which includes a genuine commitment to holy living. So he comes as this son, calling for the fruit that these prophets had called for, but he comes now calling them to repentance in light of bringing the kingdom. And then, Lord willing, next week, we'll look further at what's going on in this parable. Thanks for coming.